बिस्मिल्लाह रहमान रहीम, अस्सलाम वालेकुम लेडीज एंड जेंटलमैन। सो वेलकम टू एवरीबॉडी टू दिस ऑसम गैदरिंग ऑफ द एलीट्स ऑफ ऑफ्थाल्मोलॉजी। आई विल रिक्वेस्ट डॉक्टर ज़हर मज़री टू रिसाइट द कुरानिक वर्सेस एंड वी विल स्टार्ट द सेशन ऑफ आईवीएल इम्प्लांट्स प्रीमियम।
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر صدق الله العظيم।
हेलो अस्सलाम वालेकुम आशमानी साहब, आप ऊपर आ जाए इधर। थैंक यू। आई विल रिक्वेस्ट डॉक्टर सादिया।
बिस्मिल्लाहिर्रहमानिर्रहीम, आई एम डॉक्टर सादिया एंड टुडे आई विल बी डिस्कसिंग प्रीमियम आईओएल्स। शुड आई ऑफर इट टू एवरी पेशेंट? So this is a big question because many a times it happens that patient comes to us and they say that we want to get rid of glasses. It's just like a refractive surgery. We don't want to wear glasses for any distance intermediate to near vision. So हमें फलां डॉक्टर ने कहा कि आपका सब कुछ ठीक है and you can go ahead and have a premium IOL implant. And the thing which they are holding is only one IOL master report. So is it justified to go ahead with the patient just with an IOL master report with a premium IOL? This is my question with all the audiences sitting here, and this will be this I will be discussing right now. So the key to success for any premium IOL surgery is first of all is the patient selection, then lens selection, astigmatism correction, and surgical technique, whether you are going for phacoemulsification or femto laser assisted cataract surgery. So this will be the sequence which I'll be discussing in detail. Detail history is very important. Whenever a patient comes to you, you have to ask about any previous surgery, previous glasses, patient is using prisms or not, any ocular surface disease, systemic history of uncontrolled diabetes or glaucoma, Ehlers-Danlos or Marfan, etc. And the most important thing is that we have to ask the patient about his or her requirement. What does he want? Spectacle free at all the distances? Patient is interested in monovision? What is his job requirement? Is he patient who is a jeweler? He wants to have a very good near vision. The night the drivers, they want to have a very good distant vision. So we have to ask the patient about the job requirement. Do they drive often at night? What are their activities? So the patients who are very hypercritical, type A personalities, who are very tensed, they are not good candidates for this premium IOL implant. Those who are easygoing and those who have a very easygoing personality, they are the good candidates. Premium IOL is not recommended in patients in pilots or the patients who drive frequently at night. So after history, we have to go for the ocular examination, check the refraction, uncorrected, corrected, pinhole, intermediate, orthoptic assessment, tropias, phoreas, ocular dominance, extraocular, especially the stereopsis, contrast sensitivity to be checked because patients, they present with reduction in contrast sensitivity who have very early maculopathy, which can be missed with clinical examination. Intraocular pressure to be checked with eplanation tonometer, correction factor to be applied, then slit lamp examination, any meibomian gland disease, blepharitis, it has to be treated before proceeding with any examination, any investigation. So it is very important to treat meibomian gland disease or blepharitis before you go ahead with any other procedure. We have to optimize the ocular surface before proceeding with the investigations. Dry eyes, compromised ocular surface, corneal dystrophy, scars, these are all the contraindications for premium IOL implant. So pupil is very important. We have to look at the pupil shape. Iris colobomas, eccentric pupil, atrophic pupils, these are all contraindications. Sometimes you see a pupil like this. These are the pupil which can cause dysphotopsias post-operatively. And too large, such a large size pupil or very small pupil, these are also contraindications, because large pupil will result in halos, glare, ultimately resulting in dysphotopsias. And if the pupil size is very small, less than 2.5, then most of the time the patient is using the central part of the lens, which is used for the near vision. So he'll be having a blurry distant vision. These are again contraindications. Any active posterior segment disease is a contraindication. You should not go ahead with the premium IOL implant. Every patient should have an OCT maculo-optic nerve head done. Sometimes we can miss subtle epirectal membranes or VMTs. It can be missed. So it is recommended to do OCT of all the cataract surgery patients, not only of patients with premium IOLs. Specular microscopy to check the endothelial health, hexagonality to be more than, should be more than 60%, and CV to be less than 40%. And this CV is the first sign in patients who have guttata or Fuchs. So cornea has to be looked very carefully before we plan any further. So pupillometry, we have to check the pupil size and shift. As I already said, that less than 2.5 and more than 6 millimeter. So these are the pupil which should not be, which are not fit for trifocal implants, because they will ultimately result in halos and glare and a lot of dysphotopsias. And there are a number of machines which gives us this pupil shift, like this one. This picture is from I think Cirrus. Another one, this is from Wave Light Topolizer, and this also gives us the pupil shift here. So pupil shift of more than 0.2 is also not recommended to go for premium IOLs. Now comes the topography and tomography. We have to rule out form first changes, form first cretoconus, irregular corneas. Then in this we have to look for the K1, K2 stigmatism with excess, thinner spectrometry, and tear chamber depth external. In addition to that, we have to look at the total corneal refractive power report. If the software is not active, because you have to buy a software for that, then you can go for Holiday EKR report. For total corneal refractive power, you have to look at the 4 millimeter zone and check the astigmatism, K1, K2. For Holiday EKR report, you have to look at 4.5. Yahan pe bhi kar sakte hain, and then check the astigmatism. If the cornea is very regular, then you can use both of these. If total corneal refractive power is not available, you can use the EKR report. Now, one of the very important thing which you have to consider in each and every patient of premium IOLs is the angle kappa. Angle kappa is basically the distance between the visual axis and the pupillary axis. It's the angle between the visual axis and the pupillary axis. So it's very difficult to measure the angle kappa in patients. And nowadays, what we talk more is about the chord length, which is basically the distance between the visual axis and the pupillary axis. So there are many machines which now measure this chord length or chord mu for you, like the new versions or the new softwares of IOL Master and the LensStar. They measure this chord mu for you. And the Pentacam can also measure it for you. This is the angle kappa or chord mu. Here is the chord mu. This is the holiday report, holiday EKR report. So you also have to buy software for this. So if you don't have this software, let me show you the magnified version. So if you don't have the software, nothing to worry about. You can calculate it easily with a calculator. This is the chord mu, and how do you calculate it? Square of x plus square of I and under root. So when you square this and square this, add and then take out under root on your calculator, you will come up with this value, 0.48. So if you don't have it in your pentagram, you can calculate it. So why this is important? Because yaad rakhein ki iski value is 0.2 to 0.3. So it should not be more than 0.2 to 0.3. Angle, chord length or chord mu should not be more than 0.2 to 0.3 for premium IUL implants. So if the distance is larger, chord mu is larger, it will result in more dysphotopsias. If it is smaller, it will result in minor dysphotopsias. Then comes the abrometry. So these are the higher order abrasions. Won't go into the detail because of the shortage of time, but coma, horizontal, vertical, trefoil and spherical abrasion. These are the most important higher order abrasions which we have to see. And for trifocal or for premium IUL point of view, we are more interested in total root mean square. So total root mean square, these higher order abrasion like starburst caused by trefoils, halos by spherical abrasion, glare, shadows, ghost images, these are all the dysphotopsias which patient can experience if higher order abrasions are high. So you can check the higher order abrasion with the pentacam, total higher order abrasion over here, or you can use the CIRIS, total higher order abrasion here, 0.88. And if you look here, you can appreciate this that this increase in higher order abrasion is because of the coma as well as the spherical abrasion. Increased coma and increased spherical abrasion. So this patient has high higher order abrasions. Then Galilee may be third and fourth order, and here you look here, you will see total higher order abrasions B nazar aayega, and total root mean square higher order abrasion alag se hai, or total higher order abrasion alag se hai. So you have to look at the total higher order abrasion. Yahan niche abhi it's not the magnified enough that you can see it, but there either you can check it on pentacam, Galilee or CIRIS, total higher order abrasion. So for pentacam and Galilee or for CIRIS or MS-39, just forget about all this and just remember the value 0.5. It has to be, total higher order abrasion has to be less than 0.5. If it is less than 0.5, you can go ahead with any premium IUL implant, whether it is trifocal or EDOF or extended enhanced monofocal IULs, you can go ahead with anything. If it is between 0.5 and 0.7, you can go ahead with extended depth of focus, but not for trifocals. And if it is more than 0.7, I am talking of root mean square higher order abrasion. If it is more than 0.7, then you can only go ahead with monofocals or enhanced monofocals, not with trifocals and with extended depth of focus. And at the end is the IL power calculation. So you can you have ultrasound and optical, but it's better to go for optical devices like IUL Master, frequently used, number of formulas available for different axial lengths, which you can use for different patients. So monofocals, enhanced monofocals, EDOFs, trifocal and toric with any of the above. These are the lenses which are available in market nowadays, and you want which lens which you should go for. You have to look, after excluding everything clinically, you have to look at the chord mu, chord length, higher order abrasions, the axial length, and then you plan according to the higher order abrasions and chord mu, which type of lens you want to implant. So this is the same thing. If it is less than 0.5, you can go for any premium IUL. Between 0.5 and 0.7, you can go for EDOF, monofocals or enhanced monofocals, and more than 0.7, monofocal or enhanced monofocals. So I'll just show a case so that it's a bit easier for you to understand. So this is the right eye of a patient, pentacam scan of a right eye, pentacam scan of the left eye. After excluding everything, patient is absolutely normal, and now we want to go ahead with the scans. So now you want to check the higher order abrasion. So higher order abrasion of the right eye is 0.79. Higher order abrasion of the left eye is 0.46 or 0.49. So this is the IUL master of the same patient. So I've written it down here. Axial length 2318 and 2302. AC depth, white to white, astigmatism, HOAs and quad mu. These are the things which you have to check. So after optimizing the ocular surface, you have to validate the measurements. After validating the measurements, then you go ahead. Which formula would you like to use? Axial length is 2318, 2302. So it is a standard virgin eye. You can go ahead with any of the fifth generation, Kane, Evo K6. These are the best IL formulas which you can use for any patient. Now the patient had is astigmatism of 0.3 and 0.4, so there is no use of toric IUL implant. And normally I give on-axis incision, and it is according to the preference, your preference, what do you want to give, temporal incision or scleral incision or on-axis, but I normally give on-axis incision on axis of K2. And then you decide type of IUL. Quad mu, you have seen that it's 0.2 and 0.3, which is within normal range. So higher order abrasion, 0.79 and 0.46. So 0.79, which is more than 0.5, so you can only go for monofocal or enhanced monofocal. And other eye, 0.46, so it's just the borderline, so 0.50 and 0.7, so you can go for EDOF monofocal, enhanced monofocal. So final IUL type, enhanced monofocal in the right eye and EDOF in the left eye. So the idea of showing you this is that not every patient is fit for premium IUL trifocals. So you have to plan according to your higher order abrasions, quad mu or quad length, patient's ocular surface, and then plan whether the patient should go for premium IUL or any other IUL implant. Thank you.
Thank you, Sadia, for a very comprehensive review of literature as well as the advice. The answer is that it should not be offered to everyone. Next, I will request Dr. Noman for multimodal imaging in cataract, another continuation of the same subject.
Assalamu alaikum. First, I'd like to thank Dr. Sadia for a very comprehensive paper that has set up my talk absolutely perfectly. So we're going to talk about obviously trifocal lenses, and we'll discuss a few cases jisme post-operative surprises and problems aaye aur usko kis tarike se deal karna hai. So before we talk about what we can give to the patient, we have to understand what the lens is going to give to the patient. So you need to understand that trifocal jo hai, it is dividing the lens, it is dividing the light into three foci, and therefore you're not going to get perfect vision in either all three of them. Distance mein you're going to get the best vision, obviously, because the maximum light comes at the distance. Then you have some in the intermediate and in the near. So if you look at the middle and the near, you have slight blur. So you have to explain to the patient that you're not going to be seeing as a young patient or a young person, and there are certain compromises with these trifocal lenses. And similarly with the EDOFs as well. You have to divide your high order aberrations in not just entire eye or cornea. You have a difference between the internal aberrations and the external aberrations, and you have to understand that. Obviously, when you implant the lens, you're removing the natural lens, so you're removing a lot of the internal aberrations, but you will induce some when you put the lens in. And then we have to understand where. Now the big important thing is the cornea going to support this trifocal lens? So the cornea has its own contrast sensitivity, its own modulation transfer function, and is that cornea going to support your trifocal lens or not? And that is very important, and that is what Dr. Sadia was talking about with the root mean square, and if the cornea is smooth or if there's a problem with that cornea. And then on top of that, you've got the tear film. The tear film is extremely important because that's the first. So the cornea is not the first optical surface. It's the tear film that's the first optical surface. And any fluctuation in the tear film is going to cause not only a problem in higher orders, but also lower orders. It can change all the way up to 1 to 2 diopters of power just if they have extreme dry eyes. So we have to be mindful of that as well. And then we can see this in a variety of different ways, like the iTrace rings that you can see here, or the tear film breakup time, or the fluorescein breakup time. Then we failed to recognize how common a problem dry eye is. We did this study a couple of years ago during the COVID era, and we did it in young patients. You can see the mean age is 30 years of age, and we got a prevalence of about 43.6%, which is about some, we are amongst the highest percentage wise in the world. So we actually have to be very careful when we're implanting these patients. And of course, we published that. So the first case I want to discuss is, this is a 60-year-old patient, and he was part of a clinical trial we were running at the time with multifocal lenses and EDOFs. And once he was done, you can see that the patient was absolutely, his refraction was fine. He was 6'6", but his complaint was that he went out at night, he could not see a truck that was 1 meter away. And when it came up to a meter, he could then see the truck. So he was practically blind because of that light of the truck. Now, we had to figure out why that was happening, because, and then we did the epithelial map. So you can see if the epithelium is incredibly smooth, so we don't have any dry eye, we don't have any corneal problems in terms of the epithelium. His theoretical visions in both of them are absolutely spot on. There's no problem there. And then when we look at the angle kappa, that could have been a problem as well. Angle kappa was absolutely fine, and there was no problem there as well. And then high order aberrations, you can see the coma, trefoils, astigmatism, secondary astigmatism, they're all absolutely okay. So we were baffled here exactly what's going on with this patient. Then we did something called the iTrace, and it gives you a really useful tool called the retinal spot diagram, which, so we have to understand that our high order aberrations are divided into these certain models, coma, trefoil, and some of those higher orders actually don't fall into these different models. So we see that there's this one bump on the blue, on the outside of the lens. We see this one bump, and you can see the reference on the side, that these circular round things that we see, that's the reference. So that was that one point that was causing the problem. But where was that one point coming from? And that one point was coming from, it was a contracted rexus. The rexus was either too small or it contracted too much post-surgery, and that was causing light dispersion. If this patient had a monofocal lenses, it wasn't a problem, but trifocals already disperse light, and therefore this contracted rexus made it even worse and made his life extremely difficult. And that was the problem. We did a YAG laser in this patient, simple. No IOL exchange, nothing, and the retinal spot diagram, it went down. The patient was incredibly happy after, and he still has that lens to this day. So that's another point. It's not just the pre-op. You have to understand the high-order aberrations post-operatively and what they're doing to the lens as well. Then you have another case where this was a referral patient from someone, and she came to us with a problem in her vision, had trifocal in both her eyes. And in her left eye, she had a +1 refractive surprise. She also had an astigmatism, so therefore she should not have had trifocals in the first place. It should have been a toric trifocal. But again, the problem was hazy vision. Even after giving her glasses and everything, she was still incredibly unhappy, even in a distance vision. So let's see what was going on. So if you now look at the epithelium, the incredible hypertrophy in the epithelium. There's something wrong with either the cornea or the tear film. You don't get an epithelium that's this hypertrophied unless there's some problem, right? So then we look at the theoretical vision, and we get some problem in the entire eye, mainly originating in the cornea. And we look at the other eye, we see something very similar. We did the topographies of this patient. You can see elevation maps look good. The sagittal curvature maps look good, but then there's some corneal thinning. So these things are not correlating. So what's going on? And I just want to repeat one thing. This patient has not given any history of any type of surgery in her eye. Now we look at the other eye, we see something very similar in the other eye as well. Sagittal curvatures are fine, elevations are fine, but then the cornea is thin. So what's going on? Is this a keratoconus patient, but the sagittal curvatures are fine? Post-refractive surgery patient, is it irregular cornea? So to find that out, we saw anterior segment OCT of this patient. And then now you can see that there's actually a microkeratome flap that was made in this patient. And then the other thing that you can see is that there's an undulating stroma. There was an improper ablation in this cornea. And this led to epithelial hyperplasia. That epithelial hyperplasia is causing all sorts of vision problems. And this was the case that we should be seeing before we implanted the lens. The other eye, we're seeing exactly the same findings, right? So the diagnosis of this patient was again hyperopic error because of the LASIK surgery, but then also irregular laser ablation is now causing light dispersion and problems in her cornea. So to enlighten what can happen after trifocal implantation if you're not looking at the cases properly, and we have to then go for IOL exchanges or other treatments. And this was a very short presentation just to highlight that issue and to show that multimodal imaging is not just for retinal surgeons or medical retina. Multimodal imaging is very true for refractive and cornea specialists as well. So thank you very much.
If you have such a huge knowledge, then you can easily decide when to go and when not to go for the premium IOL implants. So there are various types of premium IOL. We have to decide between premium IOL, multifocal IOLs, or EDOF IOLs. So there is a sort of comparative analysis as well. So first we will discuss briefly the very features of the two types of IOL implants. I will not go into it. People like to have such a good vision in daylight, night, evening, mesopic vision, everything. People are demanding so much that they need good quality of vision and good quality of color visions as well. I will not go, everybody knows the details of these lenses, the steps in these trifocal lenses, and various three levels, near, distance. I will not go in detail, everybody knows. So something about EDOF lenses. Generally, EDOF lenses, the first generation EDOF lenses are basic formation. The lens is in the center. There is 1 millimeter zone, aspheric zone. It has the property of making the beam pseudo non-refractive beam that passes directly through this area, through all the media into the macula, and it gives a fair quality of near and intermediate vision. And the peripheral part of the lens is for monofocal distance, for the distance vision. So it is sort of a lens that can give good distance vision and fair intermediate vision, to some extent near vision as well. But this was not very good. The results were not satisfactory in many patients. My own experience is that I was not very, very satisfied with these patients, particularly for near vision. So there is advancement. Everywhere there is advancement. People are looking forward to improvement in everything. So here there was next generation presbyopia correcting monofocal intraocular lens implants were they came into practice. Inka farq ye hai pehle ki inka lens, there not only the central aspheric zone that makes pseudo non-refractive beam, but there is an area of 2.2 millimeter diameter around that has wavefront improvement technology that takes the wavefront light from the periphery of the center and then it brings it into alignment with the central pseudo non-refractive beam. So with the same lens, you can have better quality of vision, you can have better field of vision, and you can have better illumination by adding the light energy from the mid-peripheral zones. You can have better quality of light with the same sort of lens, and you can have good vision in the lower illumination of the atmosphere. So contrast sensitivity is also improved as compared to the other lenses. This is good lens, Elon lens. Mazi sahab use karte hain ye wala lens, acha lens hai iska result. Renner ne banaya, but using the principle of aspheric spherical aberration. I never used it. Jo use karte hain kindly apna mujhe feedback dijiyega. But inke lens thickness yahan pe istemal nahi hota, but it is good lens. Jahan pe use hota hai wahan pe achhi reports iske bare mein. Zeiss ka hai, Atlara lens, isme quality iski hai trifocal ke bhi, iska center is aspheric, and it also has the quality of EDOF as well. So it has a combination of EDOF as well as trifocal. Now this is wavefront shaping technology ki jo advantage hai. Monofocal you have no vision for near and distance, but okay for good. Ye jo hamara monofocal distance lenses hai, ye lenses jo hain Atlara ya jinke aap wavefront modulation jisme karte hain, you have better quality of distance, intermediate, and to some extent fair amount of near vision. so it's good for the monofocal enhanced lenses. वो जनरल साहब को बताएंगे हमें बेहतर तरीके से मोनोफोकल एनहांस्ड लेंसेज के बारे में. सो ये मैं डिटर्मिनर जो है बहुत अच्छी तरह डिटेल से डॉक्टर सादिया ने बता दिए ये चीज़ें क्या देखना है, क्या देखना है प्री ऑपरेटिवली, क्या नहीं देखना, सूटेबल कौन है कौन नहीं है, एवरीथिंग इज डन. सो दिस थिंग इज वेरी थर्ड डन बाई सादिया. दिस पेशेंट माई ओन डेटा, सॉरी. So these are the number of patients, trifocal, 44 patient, 30 bilateral, 14 unilateral. EDOF 54, 29, 15 and 4. ये इसकी डिटेल मैंने वही चीज़ है. सो पोस्ट ऑपरेटिव रिफ्रैक्टिव एरर इसमें दिखाते हैं कि मोस्टली इमेट्रोपी इज सीन बेटर इन ट्राइफोकल एज कम्पेयर टू ईड ऑफ 92% versus 83-85%. अदर इज द रिफ्रैक्टिव एरर दैट इज अगेन लेस सीन इन दिस ट्राइफोकल एज कम्पेयर टू ईड ऑफ. पोस्ट ऑपरेटिव रिफ्रैक्टिव एरर दैट वाज देयर नो फाइनल वेल आउटकम आर वेल एक्विटी आउटकम 6 VN 92% with N6 vernier, 92% in trifocals and only 80% in EDOF, and that was N8 not N6. There was hardly anybody who had N6 VN except for very bright light. 6% had this 6-12 and N8 here, and 6-6 and N10 not N8, and so is for the remaining. So means the near VN is not good in these patients. Another criteria, intermediate VN. 74 patients were satisfied with trifocals. And that was the best, sorry. 65% with this and 70% slightly better satisfaction for intermediate level with this EDOF lenses as compared to trifocals. Note dissatisfaction. Why there was dissatisfaction and how much? Blurring 30% here, equal on either side. There was there dysphotopsia, halos and glare, especially 12% here and 6% in EDOF. EDOF patients they have less dysphotopsia. They are more comfortable in such a condition. Similarly, contrast sensitivity is almost every person with trifocal, they had different difficulty in contrast vision, especially in low illumination, mesopic vision, night dinners, they had difficulty in seeing the people. Sometimes they say that we cannot recognize the people. It is difficult to see properly in the low illumination, whereas it was much better in this variety, EDOF. 60% has this deficiency and 32% patient had fairly good contrast sensitivity, which is not seen in trifocals. So this is a picture. Again, same in diagrammatic, I have already seen halos, contrast sensitivity. So in a summary, compared with EDOF lenses, trifocal lenses resulted in better quality of post-operative refraction and uncorrected near VN. Although distance and intermediate VN was not significantly different between the two groups. However, halos, glare and contrast sensory issues were slightly higher in trifocals as compared to EDOF lenses. My friends can share their experience, but that is what I have observed, and that matches with the literature as well. Thank you very much. I request Dr. Madri Saab, आज ही मेरे साहब आप अपने इकॉनमी को और लेंस को मिलाइए आपस में.
बिस्मिल्लाहिर्रहमानिर्रहीम. माय टॉपिक इज कंबाइनिंग इकॉनमी विद क्वालिटी इन प्रीमियम आईओएल प्रैक्टिस. एंड माय डेफिनेशन ऑफ प्रीमियम आईओएल इज अ लिटिल डिफरेंट फ्रॉम दीज जॉइंट्स ऑफ ऑप्थल्मोलॉजी. आई इंक्लूड द स्क्वायर एज सिंगल पीस प्री लोडेड आईओएल देन प्रीमियम आईओएल एज वेल. this is where the term premium was coined with launch of Acrisof IQ and the family of aspheric IULs. And then came the era of preloaded IULs. And why I call those IULs premium IULs? Because in our part of the world, especially in this economic crisis, their laptop is stuck. हाँ शेर सुना देने हैं। हम कलामी का शरफ ना ही तजल्ली का जहूर इट्स पॉइंट्स टू मूसा अलैहिस्सलाम टॉकिंग टू गॉड ऑन तूर हम कलामी का शरफ ना ही तजल्ली का जहूर शौक का आलम के हम हर रोज जाएं सुए तूर हम कलामी का शरफ ना तजल्ली का जहूर शौक का आलम के हम हर रोज जाएं सुए तूर कैसे लफ्जों में बयां हो हम कलामी का मजा कैसे लफ्जों में बयां हो हम कलामी का मजा हजरत मूसा से पूछो मिलता है कैसा सुरूर कैसे लफ्जों में बयां हो हम कलामी का मजा हजरत मूसा से पूछो मिलता है कैसा सुरूर जा बजा और कूबकू हैं इश्क की ये मंजिलें जा बजा और कूबकू हैं इश्क की ये मंजिलें आगे है सहराए सीना पीछे है वो कोहे तूर आगे है सहराए सीना पीछे है वो कोहे तूर हम कलामी की वो लज्जत दीद की वो सरखुशी शाह खूबा ने सजा कर सजा देकर वो छीना सब सुरूर देखिए मैं इस कदर पे चीदा तो लिखता नहीं कुछ तो है हरफे सुखन पर आपको हासिल बूर मजीद मलिक साहब के लिए देखिए मैं इस कदर पे चीदा तो लिखता नहीं कुछ तो है हरफे सुखन पर आपको हासिल बूर कब करम पर हूँ वो मायल कब खुले अपना नसीब रहमत रब्बी का देखें कब हो कैसे हो जहूर दीदनी है इश्क की और हुस्न की आवेजशें दीदनी है इश्क की और हुस्न की आवेजशें मजहरी की आजजी और शाह खूबा का गुरूर थैंक यू वेरी मच तो कंबाइनिंग इकोनॉमी विद क्वालिटी इसलिए हमारे पार्ट ऑफ द वर्ल्ड में ज़रूरी है कि अब इस इकोनॉमिक क्राइसिस में जो प्राइसेस हैं वो जो लेंथ 25,000 रुपये का था एक दो साल पहले अब वो 70,000 हमारे अपने मिसाइल की वजह से डॉलर प्राइस के चेंज आने की वजह से पहुंच गया है तो मैंने सबसे पहले जो इसमें एस्फेरिक आईयूएल अगर आपने सिंगल पीस डालना हो या मल्टी पीस डालना हो तो एक नई ऑप्शन आई थी उससे मैंने आगाज़ किया प्रेजेंटेशन का असल में मल्टी पीस आईयूएल में हमारे पास दो आईयूएल्स अवेलेबल रहे हैं एक होया का और एक एल्कॉन का और मेरा चूंकि हैप्टिक फिक्सेशन में और टकिंग में भी इंटरेस्ट है तो उसमें तो एल्कॉन का लेंथ ही क्वालिफाई करता था ओवरऑल 13 मिलीमीटर्स डायमीटर होने की वजह से लेकिन इत्तेफाक से वो प्रीमियम आईयूएल्स में फॉल नहीं करता बिकॉज इट डजंट कैरी स्क्वायर एज एंड इट्स एन स्फेरिक आईयूएल तो रिसेंटली कोवा हैज लॉन्च्ड प्री सेट प्री लोडेड एस्फेरिक स्क्वेयर एज मल्टी पीस आईयूएल एंड दे हैव अ वेरी स्ट्रॉन्ग एंड फ्लेक्सीबल हैप्टिक मेड ऑफ PGFA मटीरियल इट डजंट ब्रेक इजिली सो इट्स एन एक्सीलेंट लेंस एंड इट कम्स प्री लोडेड एज वेल सो आई हैव यूज इट इन रूटीन इम्प्लांटेशन एज वेल एज फर्स्ट लेवल फिक्सेशन एंड हैप्टिक टकिंग एंड एक्सटर्नलाइजेशन एंड इट्स इकोनॉमिकल एज वेल एज कंपेयर टू बोथ होया एंड एल्कॉन द सेकेंड थिंग आई वॉन्टेड टू डिस्कस इन कंबाइनिंग इकोनॉमी विद क्वालिटी इज द सिंगल पीस एस्फेरिक स्क्वेयर एज डिजाइन यू नो दे आर रेंजिंग नाउ इन द रेंज ऑफ 50,000 to 70,000 एंड वी आर लकी दैट सौराबजी पटेल वॉज मैन्युफैक्चरिंग a single piece square edge lenses here unfortunately they had to stop manufacturing those lenses with the name of Iriflex It was as good as Renner aspheric. And now the American lenses and some European lenses are available, which are excellent and comes even preloaded. And the price range is quite economical. One of them I am using is from Aaron Scientific USA with the name of Aqua Sensi lens, SY. The other one is from a Swiss made. So we can always go for economical options and give the patient a spheric and square edge lens. And then comes the question of ADOF. And if we go for the top ADOF IUL, Professor Majid Malik mentioned, the price is almost 2.5 million, as good as high a price as for a trifocal IUL. And the Lucidus IUL, Professor Majid Malik had shown, was used to be quite economical before start of this economical crisis. But even now, compared to that top-end lenses, this Lucidus, Elon, and Evolux, these are European origin IULs, which are quite economical, almost one-third of the price. Go, they all come around 50 to 70,000 rupees, but they behave excellently. And the other difference this Lucidus IUL has from rest of the ADOF family is that this Vivity, which was also shown by Professor Majid Malik, and Elon by Medicontour, and Evolux by Safi Italy, all those lenses, they give you the ADOF range, extended depth of focus, between far and intermediate, whereas Lucidus is the only lens which gives you extended depth of focus or a range of VN between near and intermediate. So in my experience, this character makes it a little superior to the other ADOF IULs which don't claim any near VN. So if this Lucidus IUL, which is quite economical, and Evolux IUL implanted in both eyes, they provide you about 70% of independence from glasses at near VN. But they are not that good, as it was very obvious from Professor Saab's study, as trifocals are. So both of them have pros and cons, and that's why the manufacturers are working on hybrid IULs now. So yet, ideal intraocular lens has to be manufactured. Then comes the top-end lenses like bifocal, and we have an economical lens available from Turkey with the name of Acriva Reviol. It's a plate haptic design and gives you excellent VN for far and near. It's a bifocal design and is quite economical, comes around 50 to 60,000. Then finally, the trifocal lenses come into play, and they are again 2 to 3 lakh rupees and more than 1 lakh, most of them. But there are 2-3 lenses which have the beauties of trifocality, like Quint Focal, again from Aaron Scientific. It has a little variation of panoptic design, that there are some 4 or 5 foci out of which 1 or two are subtracted in the end with some optical gimmicks, and it gives you an excellent trifocal IUL with 4 haptic design. So these, and then there is a Medicontour Liberty as well, which is also an excellent trifocal lens with phase shift technology. And another lens is here from Acriva Turkey, which is also a trifocal design, and they fall below 1 lakh. So it's just a kind of relative thing, combining economy with quality. Because we are combining economy with quality, and we are asking the patient maybe need to spend not 2.5 lakh rupees. Instead, he may spend less than 1 lakh rupees for a trifocal IUL. But we need to compare side to side multi-center trials for their to see their final outcomes. But in my experience, we are running a study on quintifocal IUL, and about 25 IULs data we are going to share in this meeting as well. And very soon we will be there with 50 IULs and share our experience. But in as long as we have analyzed our data, it behaves excellently for far near and intermediate VN. And the dysphotopsia is as if it is there with other trifocal designs like Etilara from Zeiss and Panoptics from Alcon and other trifocals like Liberty and other IULs. So this was my presentation, combining economy with quality in premium IUL practice. And alhamdulillah, we have covered it without seeing it, the slides. Thank you very much.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Assalamu alaikum. My topic was, I think so, Mazri has covered every kind of lens available in the world. So to make it, let me bring it down to something which my interest lies is, and these are known as the extended monofocals. And what is the basis of this thing? All over the world, we call it, is a premium IOS, this is the cost. And then it's the problems which we always hear about the glare, photopsia, dysphotopsia, and VN problems at night. So having what all Dr. Sadia and all our speakers like Dr. Majid Malik and have said, that we have problems. And the most important thing is that whatever we do, in the end, we should not have any problems. And those who have started, I was now, and I'm and those who, people like us who were the pioneers of what we started off. And I was just having a discussion with General Akbar when we started IOS. We never thought about anything about higher order aberration, problem with the retina or the corneal curvatures or things like that, or angle kappa, or what the new term is called, mu, called u. So these are all things which are coming up, and as the science goes on, further things are going to come up, and a lot of other things have to be taken into account. Having said so why are the monofocals still being the most commonly used? It's more than, and I'm not talking about Pakistan, I'm talking over all over the world. It's more than, I mean, whatever the, if you go into the Western world, and there's a very good, which I always, I would request all of you to read those things, is the ECRS survey by all the ophthalmologists done, whoever attend that meeting yearly, and they gave their preferences of lenses and what kind of a thing they are doing about, and the practices, which is very important to know. And they have, I'm saying, still 30-40% people are still using monofocal IOLs, and then all this time everything else has also been increasing. One thing is very much clear, with all the advancements and everything which is happening over in the world, still we have not reached a stage where we can say we have reached the ultimate. That is the reason why every time you are going to open up, after 1 year you will find something new coming up and new lens coming up. And what I'm going to talk about is the extended monofocus. And what are these? These are basically monofocus which are being added upon with such things which leads to improvement in their function and giving a vision which is better for distance and intermediate, as already Dr. Mazri has said. And why this is important? Now the change in the world, as it is happening over the world, the important thing is that what are the most people like to do nowadays? It is either they're having driving at a distance, or they have got laptops or things which are being done at more at an arm's length. So people find that these are the places where they want more, and then naturally near vision is there to do. But these are the, and the, a lot of studies which have come up that, which have trying to find out what are the maximum activities a person does, especially when he is more than 60 years of age. And more than 75% of the activities were more at the arm's length because of the advent of the these laptops and things like the screens. With this thing, people have gone back, and my topic today was a U-turn. That is basically you coming back to the monofocus. I think so, it's still not on. So I'm going to carry on. And in this aspect, one of the lenses which we talked about is Evolux, which has been utilized by SIFI in Russia and in Italy, and they have made this lens, and which is there also. And nowadays, another lens which has come up, which is in Pakistan, available in Pakistan, is Rainer's, is EMV, which is the lens, which is again an extended monofocal. And what is the benefit of these things is that they come up with a vision which you can see at a normal distance and at a distance at a far off, and also till the intermediate. But one concept which I would like to throw at you is that how it has been done. The latest concept I would say with this thing is that you should be knowing the dominant eye and what is the non-dominant eye. If you know this concept, that there's always a one common, as we have a arm, which is somebody is right-handed, somebody is left-handed, same is with the eyes. You can check it, and you can also ask the questions, कौन सी आम को किसे आप फायर करते हैं, अगर वो है किस आंख से आप विंक अच्छी तरह ज़्यादा करते हैं, किसको बंद करते हैं, कौन सी अच्छा है. एंड यूजली मोस्ट ऑफ द टाइम इट इज़ राइट आई. सो यू कैन ऑलवेज गो फॉर इमेट्रोपिया एट अ डिस्टेंस वीन, एंड यू कैन गो फॉर अ मोनो, दिस इज द मोनो वीन कंसेप्ट, एंड गिविंग गोइंग विद अ माइनस मायोपिक और अ मोनो वीन इन द अदर आई, इन द नॉन डोमिनेंट राइट. सो अगर आपने अगर डोमिनेंट राइट आई है तो आप उसको उसकी बायोमेट्रिक करके उसको आप उसको करें एट ईमेट्रोपिया, और दूसरे लेंस ये जो मोनोवीन है आप उसको एट अ माइनस 0.5 से लेके 0.25, 0.5, 0.75 से लेके माइनस 1.50 तक आप ले जाएं अकॉर्डिंग टू उसकी नियर वीन की कितनी उसकी रिक्वायरमेंट है. And with this thing, you can blend the vision. So this is the blended vision, which can lead to a person having accomplishment of both of them, along with this thing, with a negligible amount of glare extracted at night. And this concept has been very much been taken up, especially in Rainer EMV lens, which has just been launched in Pakistan. It's been there for last couple of years in the world. And I have been using it for the last 6 months, and I had basically a bit kind of a studies in with him. Huh? Extended monofocal. So taking the, it's been opening up, but the process, I think so, we are almost at the fag end of our bulk. We have crossed the limit. So I'm just going to end in this presentation. I'm just going to show you the video. The one important thing is all of these lenses, the preloaded things, it's also very important that what are the problems which you normally face. So it is, even if it is a preloaded, how can it turn out? We have already discussed all of this thing. And just I'm going to end up with the aage chale and so in our aage le ja. So बस ये देते हैं इसमें बस. एंड दिस इज़ वॉट द कंसेप्ट इज दैट अगर आपका इफ इज़ अ पर्सन हु इज़ अ टैक्सी लॉरी और अ हंटर और अ पायलट, यू कैन पुट हिम ऑन एन ईमेट्रोपिया एंड बोथ आईज एंड आस्क हिम टू यूज ग्लासेस. बट इफ समबडी इज हैज गॉट अ डिफरेंट कंडीशन, यू कैन मेक हिम अ मिनी मोनोवियन, मॉडरेट और फुल मोनोवियन, सो विच कैन हेल्प यू the patient to understand, which achieve also the binocularities of them. But the main question which comes is economy. Aapke jitne lens hain jo abhi Dr. Mazri ne kaha tha, all of them are very expensive. But we have asked these companies that yaar, you have to come down with the prices. And hopefully they will agree, and we are going to get them in a level in which it is affordable to the other person, to the normal public. Clinical studies are always there, which is coming up. And I will end up with this thing, that it is also very important नॉट ओनली फॉर द वी हैव ऑलरेडी टॉक्ड अबाउट ग्लेयर एंड ऑल द थिंग्स व्हिच आर, कि किस तरह से वो लेंस को आप डालते हैं. अगर ये प्री लोडेड लेंस है, एंड आई एम जस्ट गोइंग टू शो दीज टू प्री लोडेड लेंसेज, कि आपको एक लेंस लोड करने में पहले इसके एविलोक्स का जो प्रॉब्लम था इसको पहले गर्म करना पड़ता था. जैसे पुराने ज़माने की गाड़ियाँ होती थी तो उसे गर्म चल पड़ी है ना मुबारक, वही मैं बता रहा हूँ कि वो एक चल पड़ी है. तो मैंने कहा इसी को ऑन करके एंड करता हूँ कि सम टाइम यू इट टेक सम टाइम. अभी जैसे ये एविलोक्स का लेंस है, इसको आपको पहले गर्म करना पड़ता है, गर्म करने के बाद आपने इसमें लेंस को चलाना पड़ता है, इट्स वेरी डिफिकल्ट टू पुट इन. So this is also very important. I have talked with the company that if you have to put this kind of a lens in, you need to have a lot of patience. Or aap ye lens dalne, it is very very rigid. It has to be, when it goes inside, it takes its own time. It takes its time to open up, and you don't feel very comfortable. And I was never very comfortable using this lens because aapko zor bahut lagana padta tha. Open bahut slow hota hai. So it. और टाइम हो रही थी एंड यू फील कि यार ये मैं किधर फंस गया हूँ. एंड देन अगर उसने कहा जी इसको पहले आप गर्म करें, गर्म पानी इसके अंदर आता है, व्हाट इज इट देन
वो नेचुरल थिंग. मगर दो मिनट पहले जो है, दो मिनट तक आपको वॉश करना है
ना. वो मैंने कहा ना,
वो दैट टू मिनट्स आर वेरी कंबर्सम,
वेरी कंबर्सम, आपको टाइम नहीं गुजरता
बहुत टाइम.
लेकिन मैंने जो अभी मैंने जो लेटली शुरू किया, ये नेक्स्ट कैसी हो जाएगी ये, एंड दिस इज द रेनर वाला. And I must appreciate, मतलब मैं आई यूज़ एल्कॉन, आई यूज़ हर किस्म के लेंस, लेकिन जितना प्री इतना अच्छा. दिस इज़ द रियल टाइम, इट्स नॉट बीन एडिटेड और एनी थिंग. वो इसमें जो सबसे अच्छी बात है कि आई विल एंड अप, मतलब इसका जो रेनर का है, एंड दैट गिव्स यू अ सच अ वो वाली बात है कि आपको इवन नाउ दे हैव, मतलब एल्कॉन वालों ने अभी क्लेरियन लेंस डाला है विद ऑल द थिंग्स, लेकिन उसको भी जब आप डाल के उसको आप देख रहे होते हैं, वो एक मशीन ऑटोमेटिक चल पड़ती है, वो जाके वो लेंस अपनी मर्जी से घूम रहा है आपको, मतलब वो एक आपका एक कंट्रोल होता है, वो ख़त्म हो जाता है आपका भी. तो आई थिंक सो इनकी तो मेरा ख्याल है ये सब कुछ करना. हाँ ये चल पड़े, शुक्र. तो ये देखें, ये बड़े आराम से अपने टाइम पर जा रहे हैं. एंड आई डोंट हैड टू यूज़ another second instrument in it. ये लेंस गया खुद अंदर जाके खुद. अरे इसमें मेरी कोई कारनामा नहीं है, इट्स द लेंस विच हैज मेड. सो दिस इज ऑल्सो वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट कि जो आप लेंस यूज करें, यू फील मोर वेरी कंफर्टेबल विद इट. तो प्री लोडेड का फायदा ये है कि वो कंफर्टेबल है, नॉट कि इट कॉजेज मोर प्रॉब्लम्स विद दिस. आई थिंक सो वी कम टू एन एंड. आई थिंक सो लेंसेज आते रहेंगे, लेकिन आई थिंक सो द पॉइंट टू रिमेंबर टेक होम मैसेज इज के इफ यू वॉन्ट टू डू प्रीमियम आईवेज, you have to be very very methodical, and it is not a simple prana zamane wala lens, you have to work a lot harder for them. With that we come to an end. Thank you very much.
And one thing that I want to add in Dr. Mazhar Ishaq's statement is counseling. You must counsel the patient, kyunki ye patient the lenses are so expensive that patient's expectations are very high. Wo ye chahte hain ki dur bhi nazar aaye, hawai jahaz mein jo banda baitha hai wo bhi nazar aaye, तो वो हम नहीं दिखा सकते उनको. तो ये इनको काउंसिल करना बहुत जरूरी है. हाँ बिल्कुल. थैंक यू वेरी मच.
कैन वी रिक्वेस्ट जनरल अकबर टू गिव द प्रेजेंटेशन?
जी सर. डॉक्टर अकबर आप ऊपर आ जाएं सर प्लीज.
ऊपर आ जाएं या नीचे ही रह जाएं? हम नीचे ही आ जाएं सर के पास आ जाएं.
सर के साथ आ जाओ, नहीं नहीं सर फिर आ जाओ।